Penguin Random House Audio presents Queen Anne, The Politics of Passion by Anne Somerset. Read for you by Hannah Curtis. Author's note. For the sake of clarity, I have updated spelling and punctuation used in original documents. Furthermore, in almost all cases, when Anne or her contemporaries used the abbreviations YE and YT in their letters, I have modernized the archaic usage by substituting the and that. Very often, Anne and her ministers ciphered their letters by substituting numbers for names. In such cases, I have omitted the numbers and replaced them with the relevant name in square brackets. Throughout Anne's lifetime, England used the Julian calendar, while continental Europe followed the Gregorian system. During the 17th century, the date in Europe was 10 days ahead of England's. With the start of the 18th century, the gap between England and Europe widened to a difference of 11 days. When dealing with events that took place in England, I give dates according to the Julian calendar. However, when describing events that occurred on the continent, or when quoting letters sent from abroad, I generally give a composite date, separated by a forward slash, indicating the date according to both the Julian and Gregorian calendars. Whereas in Stuart, England, the calendar year started on the 25th of March, I have simplified things by taking it to begin on the 1st of January. It is notoriously difficult to compare the value of money in the past with modern monetary values. However, as a very rough guide, it should be noted that the National Archives Currency Converter Service calculates that £1 in 1710 would have a spending worth of £76.59 in 2005. Chapter 1. But a Daughter. The opening weeks of the year 1665 were particularly cold, and the sub-zero temperatures had discouraged the King of England, Charles II, from writing to his sister Henrietta in France. He was always a lazy correspondent, and having little news to impart, thought it pointless to freeze my fingers for nothing. In early February, however, he took up his pen to report that the two of them had acquired a new niece. On the 6th of February, shortly before midnight at St. James's Palace in London, their younger brother James, Duke of York, had become a father to a healthy baby girl. Being without a legitimate heir, the king would have preferred a boy, and since Henrietta herself was expecting a child, Charles told her that he trusted she would have better luck in this respect. In one way, however, the Duchess of York had been fortunate, for she had had a remarkably quick labour, having dispatched her business in little more than an hour. Charles wrote that he wished Henrietta an equally speedy delivery when her time came, though he feared that her slender frame meant that she was not so advantageously made for that convenience as the far more substantially built Duchess. The King concluded that in that event, a boy will recompense two grunts more. The child was named Anne, after her mother, and if her birth was a disappointment, at least it did not cause the sort of furore that had greeted the appearance in the world of the Duke and Duchess of York's firstborn child in 1660. That baby had initially been assumed to have been born out of wedlock. But when it emerged that the infant's parents had in fact secretly married just before the child's birth, there was fury that the Duke of York had matched himself with a loose woman who was not of royal blood. Many people shared the view expressed by the diarist Samuel Pepys that he that doth get a wench with child and marries her afterward, it is as if a man should shit in his hat and then clap it upon his head. The scandal was particularly regrettable because the monarchy was fragile. Charles II had only been on his throne since May 1660, after an 11-year interregnum. In 1649, his father, King Charles I, had been executed. This followed his defeat in a civil war that had started in 1642, when political and religious tensions had caused a total breakdown in relations between king and parliament. During that conflict, an estimated 190,000 people, nearly 4% of the population, had lost their lives in England and Wales alone. In Scotland and Ireland, the proportion of inhabitants who perished was still higher. Charles I had been taken prisoner in 1646, but refused to come to terms with his opponents, and so the war had continued. By 1648, however, the royalists had been vanquished. Angered at the way the king had prolonged the bloodshed, the leaders of the parliamentary forces brought him to trial and sentenced him to death. England became a republic ruled by a Lord Protector, Oliver Cromwell, and it seemed that its monarchy had been extinguished forever. When the Royalists' principal stronghold of Oxford had fallen in the summer of 1646, Charles I's 12-year-old son, James, Duke of York, had been taken into the custody of Parliament. However, in April 1648, he had managed to escape abroad, dressed as a girl. His older brother Charles was already on the continent, having been sent overseas by their father 2 years earlier. James was only 14 when news arrived that his father had been executed on the 30th of January, 1649. In the ensuing decade, all attempts to place Charles on his late father's throne failed, and a lifetime in exile appeared inevitable for the royal brothers. In 1656, James spent some time in the French court. While there, he met with his elder sister Mary, widow of the Dutch Prince William II of Orange, who was visiting Paris, accompanied by her maid of honour, Anne Hyde. Anne was the daughter of Edward Hyde, a pompous and severe lawyer from Wiltshire, who had become a leading adviser to Charles I shortly before the outbreak of civil war. After his master's execution, he offered his services to the late king's eldest son, now styled Charles II by his adherents. Hyde moved his family to Holland, and in 1653 they took up residence at Breda, at the invitation of the widowed Mary of Orange, who bore the title Princess Royal of England. 2 years later, the princess suggested that Hyde's 18-year-old daughter Anne should become one of her maids of honour. Hyde had been reluctant to accept her offer, partly because he feared angering the late king's widow, Queen Henrietta Maria, who detested him. Finally, he consented, whereupon the queen mother was duly incensed, little guessing that within a few years she would become more intimately connected to his daughter. After their initial encounter, James had other opportunities to see Anne when he visited his sister at Breda. He was soon passionately attracted to her, for though Anne was not absolutely a beauty, there was nobody at the court of Holland capable of putting her in the shade. At this stage, she had a pretty good figure and was also universally agreed to be exceptionally witty and intelligent. Always of an amorous disposition, James tried to seduce her, but she did not prove an easy conquest. Even after he had, for many months, solicited Anne, in the way of marriage, it was only after he formally contracted himself to her at Breda on the 24th of November 1659 that she let him sleep with her. In the spring of 1660, royalist fortunes were suddenly transformed. Oliver Cromwell had died in September 1658, and over the next 15 months, England descended into near anarchy. In late April 1660, the chaotic situation was resolved when the English Parliament invited Charles II to return to England and assume the crown. On the 25th of May, Charles, now king in more than name only, landed at Dover. 4 days later, he made a triumphant entry into London, accompanied by James, Duke of York. Anne Hyde left the Princess Royal service and came back to England with her family. Her father was now the king's chief minister, with the official position of Lord Chancellor. Unaware that Anne was pregnant by the Duke of York, he began making arrangements to wed her to a well-bred, hopeful young gentleman. But before these came to fruition, James went to the king and tearfully begged permission to marry Anne. Much troubled by this development, Charles initially refused to authorize the union, but at last, after much importunity, consented. On the 3rd of September 1660, James and Anne Hyde were married at a private ceremony in the dead of night at Worcester House, the Lord Chancellor's London residence. The only witnesses were James's friend the Earl of Ossory and Anne Hyde's maidservant, Ellen Stroud. Anne was now in the advanced stages of pregnancy, but curiously her father had failed to notice this. He was therefore shocked and appalled when the king alerted him to the fact that his daughter was expecting the Duke of York's child and had married without his knowledge. Hyde demanded that Anne should be sent to the Tower, and then that an Act of Parliament should be immediately passed for the cutting off her head, and was surprised when the king demurred. However, although Charles told Hyde that he was sure the marriage could not be undone, the union was still not officially acknowledged. Anne continued to await her baby at her father's house, where she was kept confined to her room. Towards the end of September, the Princess Royal arrived in England, enraged by the prospect of having her former servant for a sister-in-law. Unnerved by this, James's commitment to Anne began to waver. He now accepted that he had been imprudent to pledge himself so precipitately, and instead of the marriage being publicly proclaimed, there grew to be a great silence in that affair. James's doubts became more pronounced when members of his court started to suggest that Anne was a woman of bad character. His best friend, Sir Charles Barclay, claimed that he and others have lain with her often, and another young man testified that once when riding pillion behind him, she reared with her hand on his blank. An assortment of courtiers provided additional explicit details of alleged trysts with Anne during her time in Holland. Richard Talbot claimed to have had an assignation with her in her father's study, recalling that as he was fondling her on the desk, a bottle of ink had overturned, causing an appalling mess. Later, the pair of them had artfully put the blame on the king's pet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.